Good morning again. We want to welcome you to our service today. We have a very special service today because we are living in very special times and very special events are transpiring around us. The title of our message today is The Axis of Evil, Hands Across the Gulf, The Axis of Evil. During World War II, the nations of Germany, Italy, and Japan were known as the Axis powers. And these powers were viewed as being evil, and not without reason. The Japanese invaded China, and the atrocities that happened in Manchuria and other places have been fairly well documented. Here we have on our slide a picture of some Japanese soldiers burying some Chinese people alive. This is a picture of two lieutenants. And they had a competition to see who could kill 100 people with their swords first. The victims of the Japanese, some were subjected to vivisection without anesthesia. They were used to test biological weapons upon, among other experiments. You heard about these things happening in Germany, at Auschwitz and places, but it happened in China too. In Germany, of course, we are well aware of the Holocaust that went on in Nazi Germany. Here at the Auschwitz, if you went one way, you would be put into the slave labor camp. If you were herded the other direction, you were sent immediately to the gas chambers. And I've seen these. I've stood right beside these crematories here, Auschwitz. It was terrible. The genocide that went on at the Bekenau and other places should never be forgotten in the history of humanity. We don't hear so much, but Italy wasn't totally without atrocities. They had lesser known concentration camps. But I think one of the worst things that Italy did happened in 1929 on February the 11th with the Lateran Treaty being signed there by Benito Mussolini and Pietro Gasperia, the diplomat for Pope Pius the 11th, restoring the political power to the Pope and the Papal States. Mussolini, you know, was not a terribly religious man in many respects, but he was willing to use politics and religion if it could benefit him. Is it any wonder, though, as we think about this, that these powers were considered an axis of evil in their day, that they were out to destroy that which was good and righteous? But friends, long before the 20th century, the Bible prophesied of another threefold axis union. The book of Revelation portrays a threefold concentration of evil that will, in the last days, attempt to rule the world while at the same time destroying God's people. This threefold axis of evil, has as its players, the beast of Revelation 13, the false prophet, and the dragon. Now, most of us who are listening to this message today are Seventh-day Adventist people, or we have been associated or familiar with Seventh-day Adventist people. And so I'm not going to take time this morning to go into a detailed study about the identity of these three powers. But we know basically, we understand that the dragon represents Satan, especially under the guise of spiritualism. Here in our picture we see, for instance, on the right, the Fox sisters that you've read about in the book, The Great Controversy. In the left, a picture of a seance. This dragon represents the devil working primarily through spiritualism. And then you have the beast of Revelation 13. We know it as the Roman Catholic Church or the Papacy. And you can read about it in Revelation chapter 13 and Daniel chapter 7. They're portrayed as a little horn power. Also in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 3 as the man of sin. And then thirdly, the false prophet is apostate Protestantism. The Protestant churches that quit protesting and became Protestants. We don't call them Protestant churches anymore. We use the pronunciation Protestant usually. It's less offensive. But these churches used to be called Protestant churches because they protested and many of them don't protest anymore. And those that have failed to protest, and those that are continuing the doctrines, the teachings, and are in bed with the papacy, friends, they have become apostate, and they are portrayed in the book of Revelation as a false prophet. If we would turn to Revelation chapter 16, the Bible teaches that there's going to be a uniting of these forces in the end time, a confederacy. In Revelation chapter 16 and in verse 13, he says, "And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet." Here we see them together, the dragon, this beast, the false prophet. And it says that they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. It says that there's going to be genuine miracles worked. Signs and wonders. In fact, in the New Testament, the word for signs is many places also the same word translated miracles. It says signs and wonders, it means miracles. This is not just simply hocus pocus, friends. If you remember, there was a man by the name of Harry Houdini, and one of his favorite things was to try to disprove spiritualists because he said it was all just hocus pocus. And much of it is today. Much of the things that people claim to be able to do is hocus pocus, but friends, not all of it. And especially as we near the end of time, we're going to see more and more and more genuine things happen that cannot be explained scientifically. These powers, this threefold axis of evil, performs miracles to deceive the political rulers of this world and will deceive the subjects under them, and they will gather the inhabitants together. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 16, verse 16, for the great day of the battle of God Almighty, the battle of Armageddon. This, friends, is hardly a far distant event, for we now see these powers working swiftly. Through the false revival of the Pentecostal churches and the celebration movement, we see a combination of apostate Protestantism and a subtle yet powerful form of spiritualism. And remember, friends, that spiritualism in its most basic form is communication with evil spirits. We think about the doctrine of the immortal soul as having something to do with spiritualism, and it does indirectly because it opens the door for spiritualism, which is the communication with evil spirits. Someone may propose to have communication with the dead. Oh, I'm going to talk to my loved one. I'm going to talk to my father or my mother or my brother or my dead child. And in the Bible, that was called necromancy. A necromancer was one who could claim to speak to the dead. And the Bible says that those people in the time of Israel were to be put to death. God said it was an evil thing because it was a deception. People were getting messages not from heaven, but from hell and from Satan. And we see this happening, reoccurring again, all under the cloak of Christianity. The law of God, we are told, is going to be a special point of controversy in this last great struggle. Turn with me to Daniel chapter 7. In Daniel chapter 7, we have portrayed before us four great beasts which come up out of the earth. The angel giving the interpretation of Daniel says that these four beasts are four kings or kingdoms which shall arise out of the earth. But then there was a little horn power that comes out of the fourth kingdom. And this little horn power becomes the focus of the rest of Daniel 7. But concerning this power, in Daniel 7 and verse 25, it says, "He shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of times." And friends, this power, as you look through and you study it, and we don't have time to go through all of it today, but there are at least nine identifying marks of this power that are portrayed here in Daniel chapter 7. And all these nine can relate to one and only one power in all the world that has ever existed, and that's the Roman Catholic Church, the papacy. And the papacy is the one that would think to speak great words against the Most High, all under the cloak of Christianity. It would wear out the saints of the Most High. And the most conservative estimates are that during the time of the persecution of the Dark Ages and the Inquisitions, the Catholic Church put to death at least 50 million martyrs. And that's the most conservative estimates, friends. Some estimates are much higher. They would think to change times and laws. Why claiming to uphold the Ten Commandments? They declare that God requires obedience to them. But the papacy has drastically altered the Ten Commandments. The second commandment that forbids idol worship has been totally removed from the Decalogue. And they have taken the Tenth Commandment and they've split it into two, so you still have Ten Commandments. You see? But now the third commandment becomes the second. That which had been the fourth becomes the third. And the fourth has been especially altered because that was the commandment that deals with the seventh-day Sabbath. And now it doesn't mention anything in the catechisms in the way they teach the commandments about the seventh day. They teach that you should keep holy the first day of the week. The day dedicated to not only the sun god, but the day dedicated to the god that they worship in the place of the god mentioned in the first commandment, the Lord God. They worship a god called the Trinity. A god according to Daniel 11 that their fathers knew not. And so though they claim to keep God's law, though they claim it's important to keep God's law, friends, they have tried to destroy God's law, His commandment-keeping. People will see this, and they will speak up, and they will lift up their voice like a trumpet, and they shall not be quiet. Now, most of these changes have been accepted by Protestants, and so they're now Protestants. Even though most Protestants do not use images and do not want images in their church, they don't protest against that. They don't have any problem with that hardly. And of course, they all keep Sunday. Almost all of them worship the Trinity. But what did Jesus say about His law? In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 18, He says that not one jot or one tittle shall fall from the law until all be fulfilled. He says, as long as heaven and earth are here, My law will stand. Because, friends, the law of God is a revelation of His character and of His will. It is a transcript of His character and must forever endure. And not one of the Ten Commandments, friends, has been made null or void. Not one jot or one tittle has been removed. Notice what we've been told in Psalms 119. Psalms 119 first, in verse 89. He says, forever, O Lord, Thy word is settled in heaven. For how long? Forever. And friends, if it's settled in heaven, it ought to be settled in our hearts. Don't you think so? Amen. In Psalms 111 and verses 7 and 8, it says, the works of His hands are verity and judgment. All His commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. We've been told in the book Great Controversy on page 615, Romanism in the old world and apostate Protestantism in the new world, or in the new, will pursue a similar course, and she's speaking in context of persecution, toward those who honor all the divine precepts. And in the book The Desire of Ages on page 636, we are simply told that coming events cast their shadows before. God usually doesn't, friends, let an event take His people totally by surprise. There are shadows that show these events that are coming, and we, friends, are today seeing heavy shadows, shadows that are merging right back into the very reality of what is coming. This year, on January the 21st, there were some ominous shadows cast forth in Fort Worth, Texas area, at what is called the Kenneth Copeland Ministries. Some of you have heard of Kenneth Copeland. While hosting a large group of televangelists and ministers for a session this year, Kenneth Copeland introduced the Anglican Bishop Tony Palmer, Anglican/Episcopal Bishop Tony Palmer, who comes from the Communion of Evangelical Episcopal Churches. And Tony Palmer gave a short history of himself to explain the real purpose of his visit, and that was to encourage unity while claiming that the Reformation was no longer valid, and then he delivered a personal video message from Pope Francis to Kenneth Copeland and to this group. And he claimed that Pope Francis was a close friend and even a spiritual father and mentor to him. And sure enough, he had the video. And the Pope gave a greeting, speaking first in just a little bit of English and then in Italian. And they provided subtitles in the video. And in this message, the Pope claims to greet the people with a message of love to God and love to brothers and sisters. He then states that he indeed has been a friend with Tony Palmer for many years. After greeting, he speaks of his yearning to see God's work among his people. He laments that they, Christians, have been separated by sins. He declares that all share in this blame, but he yearns for the separation to come to an end. And then he speaks almost as a parable. He speaks of Joseph in Egypt when his brothers came to buy bread and uses it as a symbol to represent how they must encounter one another as brothers. He says we must cry together like Joseph did. These tears will unite us, the tears of love, he says. Pope Francis then declares that he is speaking to them as a brother and desires that they might embrace one another and together worship Jesus Christ as the only Lord of history. The Pope then gives his thanks that the people have listened and asks the favor of their prayers. He pleads that the Lord will unite them all to encourage those listening, and he says, come on, we are brothers, let us give each other a spiritual hug. Let God complete the work he has begun. And this is a miracle, the miracle of unity has begun. The Pope ends his message by quoting the Italian author Manzoni, and he then asks that those listening might bless him, after which he declares a blessing upon them. After the video of the Pope is over, Kenneth Copeland, he leads the congregation in a prayer for the Pope. His prayer ends with Copeland speaking in some unknown tongue or gibberish. Copeland then has Bishop Palmer record a video message from him to the Pope, assuring the Pope of Copeland's desire to be in unity, and then he pronounced a repetitive blessing upon the Pope, backed up in unison by the congregation with him. And how do we understand this now? What do we make of this? And what I've done now, I've just given you a very short summary of what happened. But we're going to now take time, and it's going to take some time, to look at this in detail and try to understand and cipher what all this means, try to interpret the data. Let's begin with the players. Pope Francis, he's the best known of these three. He's the leader of 1 billion plus Roman Catholics. He is the first Jesuit, the first South American ever to be elected pope. Insiders say, in fact, that he was a leading candidate during the last conclave when Benedict XVI was elected. He comes across as simple, humble, very friendly. Though his theology in some respects is strictly orthodox, he has made calls for unity and spoken peaceably to and about those of other faiths, including Islam. Who is Kenneth Copeland? Kenneth Copeland is perhaps, if not the, one of the leading Pentecostal evangelicals and televangelists in the United States today. His ministry is based a little northwest, about 20 miles northwest of the center of Fort Worth, Texas. He has 33 acres of property that include Eagle Mountain International Church, television production and audio recording facilities, a warehouse, distribution facilities, residence for the Copeland family, which, by the way, has 18,000 square feet, estimated to be worth $6 million. It includes the Kenneth Copeland Airport, which includes two Cessna Jet Airlines, one which has a new cost of over $22 million. The ministry is known as KCM, Kenneth Copeland Ministries, and it employs about 500 people. Now, Copeland was born in 1936. I believe it was the same year the Pope was born. And was first a music artist making popular recordings. In November 1963, he states that he was born again. And after that, Copeland says that he committed the rest of his life to gospel ministry work. In fall of 1967, he enrolled as a student at Oral Roberts University and soon became a chauffeur and a pilot, the pilot for Oral Roberts. Today, he is seen on television and holds meetings in all parts of the world. Tony Palmer. Palmer was born in the United Kingdom. He moved to South Africa as a teenager, met his wife, who's an Italian there, and together with their children, they live in South Africa today. I'm sorry, they lived in South Africa, but they now live in Wiltshire, England. While he was living in South Africa, he claims to have had a born-again experience, and after his conversion experience, he and his wife immediately began sharing what they understood to be the gospel to all the people who lived in their suburb. Early in their experience, they began watching Kenneth Copeland and his message of evangelical Pentecostalism, and it struck a chord in their hearts and encouraged them. Shortly after this time, Palmer claims to have gone to Rhema Bible Training College, founded by Kenneth Hagin, and received training for the ministry. He went to work in South Africa and within a short period of time was the director of KMC, Kenneth Copeland Ministries, in Africa. After 2.5 years, Palmer claims to have received a call from Rome, and we'll look at that in a little bit, though he doesn't say where this call within Rome came from. But he received a call from Rome to work towards and with the Roman Catholic Charismatic Renewal. And the Roman Catholic Charismatic Renewal features, among other things, prophecy, faith healing, and glossolalia. Do you know what glossolalia is? It comes from a Greek word. It's speaking in tongues. Later, Palmer went to work for the Catholic Church in Argentina. Do you know anyone who's from Argentina? That's right. That's where he met Cardinal Mario Bergoglio, and who would later become Pope Francis. During this time, Palmer became good friends with the Cardinal, and the Cardinal became a mentor to Palmer as they often visited and studied together. In 2002, Palmer and his wife founded what was called the ARC community. In their logo, interestingly, in their logo for the word ARC, they don't have the letter A, they have a triquetta. Do you know what the triquetta is? It's that symbol for the Trinity that looks like three loops. So this is emphasizing this is a very important part of their ministry and what they're doing involves with the Trinity. Now, he is a bishop of the Communion of Evangelical Episcopal Churches. And that group was formed in 1995. And I have here a statement from their website that they are a concentrated effort to blend charismatic experience, biblical renewal, liturgical renewal, and sacramental worship. Tony Palmer has also completed a short course in biblical archaeology, biblical studies from of UNISA University. He has supposedly a master's degree in philosophy from the College of Theology that's located at in Florida. It's called St. Alcuin's Seminary, although it has no certification that we know of. He has supposedly an English teacher certificate, which took just a few hours to get somehow. Some of his credentials don't look so good, but that really isn't what's so important about him. The CEEC, this group that he belongs to, this Community of Evangelical Episcopal Churches, it's actually a relatively small group. But it cannot be denied that within the circle of the Pope and within the circle of Pentecostal evangelicals, Tony Palmer is a notable person who has to be taken seriously. Palmer's visit to Kenneth Copeland Ministries and the message from the Pope has lit up the internet. And there are multiple sites on YouTube where this service and the Pope's message have been posted. Now, with this overview and background, we're now going to examine in more detail the message of Tony Palmer to Kenneth Copeland Ministries and the Pope's message back. Now, due to our time constraints today, we can't go into every detail that we'd like to. But we are publishing an old pass in the April issue, details that you won't be able to get today. So if you need to review this, if you want more understanding on this, you want to go a little deeper in it, be sure to be watching for your old pass for April, because this all is going to be in it and more. And I'm going to tell you something, friends. I'm going to say very humbly to you. There are people who've already made some comments about this. People who are based in Australia and Thousand Oaks and other places. But I'm going to tell you that you're not going to hear anything from those people like you're going to hear today. because there are certain aspects of what we're going to say today and have already said that these people cannot and will not touch. As we'll see, Palmer makes some very bold statements, but we also shall see that some are simply incorrect and others are only partially a picture of reality. And so I'm going to quote some now. He spoke for several minutes. The whole transcript will be available to you in OPAS, but I'm just going to quote portions, and some portions will be longer because you need to understand the context. You need to see what he's saying in whole. But he stated to the people there at Kenneth Copeland Ministries, he says, "We have been raised in the word of faith." And that expression, word of faith, goes back to Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland. These are expressions that they use to express their understanding of the gospel. They call it the word of faith. "We have been raised in the word of faith. We worked for Kenneth and Gloria in South Africa, but the call that we got to Italy was the call from Rome." He says, "I got a call, an email actually, from Rome saying, 'Tony, we've seen your ministry and we'd like you to share your ministry with the Roman Catholic Charismatic Renewal.'" Now, he doesn't specify where or where from within Rome this, quote, call originated. Rome, of course, is the headquarters of the Catholic Church, the home of the Vatican, and yet there are many different units and divisions. He does not say it was directly from the Vatican, or if so, from what part. This area is a little bit of gray. But without question, he began to work, not just simply for Catholic people, but for the Catholic Church. He goes on to say, "And so I was working with the Catholic Church. My wife was a charismatic Catholic. My children were going to a Catholic school, so we raised our kids Catholic, charismatic, Pentecostal, evangelicals." Jesus was all of those, you know. Did you know that? You know, I'm not too sure I know that. Now, it's true that there is a biblical understanding to this concept called charismatic. It comes from a Greek word called charisma, which we usually translate as grace. There is a truth to this concept of being evangelical. In fact, those of you who have studied A.T. Jones, remember that he wrote a pamphlet called An Appeal for What? Evangelical Christianity, right? Because in its most fundamental sense, the term evangelical comes from a Greek word which means a giver of the good news or the giving of the good news, the giving of the gospel. There is a truth to this idea of Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in the early reign, as recorded in Acts chapter 2. And Jesus certainly was filled with the Spirit, wasn't he? But based upon the way we commonly use those terms or hear them used, the way that those terms are commonly shared in nominal Christianity today, friends, I want to tell you that I take exception and I take offense to say that Jesus was like that, was like these things represent today, with this speaking in tongue gibberish and flying from the chandeliers and rolling in the aisles and whatever else sometimes is done. This idea of going out and preaching a sloppy gospel, a do-nothing gospel. No, I take great exception to this. I believe it is blasphemy to so portray our Redeemer. Palmer's wife did indeed convert to Catholicism. So we might ask, well, why doesn't Palmer? Why does he stay in Anglican Episcopal? I believe, friends, it's because he's a better tool of Rome working from without than from within. He goes on and he says this, "Jesus was sacramental. He instituted the sacraments. He did the things that were required of him in the synagogue. He believed in sign and symbol. He used it all the time in his parables, but he was also evangelical because he said you have to be born again. It is written. He was also the contemplative. He was also the charismatic. How much of Jesus do you want? Do you only want one denomination of Jesus? Jump in, get it all. No, thank you. No, thank you. I shall not jump in and get all of the man of sin or the false prophet, either one." So he begins to speak about the Pope. And he says, "So, Padre, Mario, Father Mario. He took me aside when he heard about my testimony about having this ecumenical family, and he started a friendship with me. Because you see, when Palmer went to Argentina, that's where the Pope was cardinal, you remember, in Argentina. And so they got together because he said, whenever you go to work in an area, you always go and you ask the highest Catholic official in that area if you can have permission to work in the area. So he went and explained his work, and of course, the then cardinal gave him his complete blessing. He says, we started studying together, meeting more often to a point where he became one of my mentors. So I said to him, and this is as he's talking to him later, because the Pope has called him now. The Pope has called him and wants him to come to the Vatican. He says, so I said to him, Pope Francis, I can't believe you're phoning me. I don't know how to react to you. I was just being honest. He said, what do you mean? I said, you're the Pope of the Universal Church, 1.2 billion people, and I'm just an everyday clergyman doing his bit for the kingdom. Well, beloved, there is a church of 1.2 billion people, but it is not God's church. It is part of the synagogue of Satan, the Bible says. And to use such language, it should make any Protestant either sick to your core, to cringe, or to have goosebumps to think that this is the way Protestants would speak in such glowing language about the man of sin. And he goes on to say, he said, quoting the Pope, Tony, we cut coven. And I listened to the tape recording several times carefully. And this is exactly what he says. Now, maybe he meant covenant. Maybe he meant that. But he said, we cut coven. You know what a coven is, don't you? That's what he said. But I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. Maybe he meant covenant. Maybe we have an agreement. We are brothers. He said, nothing will change our friendship. I was blessed because all of these stories you have heard about Francis, about picking his friends up in his Pope Mobile and taking them all and going out to visit people, this, he hasn't changed his spots. Notice that the Pope claims that he and Tony have a covenant. They claim to be brothers. Continuing, he says, so I went last Tuesday, I went to see him. So this was the week before. It was on the 14th of January of this year. We had the morning together, just me and him, the whole morning in his apartments. And I said, so what's the agenda? Why did you call me? And he said, I have no agenda. There is nothing to discuss. That's a father. That's a mentor. So I started to tell him, I can't believe I'm sitting here. You know how much we can do together? Yes. And we made a covenant to work for unity for the church. Continuing. I said, listen, next week I'm going to Kenneth Copeland Ministries Ministers Conference, and I told him about you. I told him all your crazy stories. I said, there's going to be thousands of leaders, and these guys have their jets, they've got TV shows, and I said, they've got churches of 10,000. 2,000, 20,000? I said, these are big fishes. So he said, well, what do you want me to do? And I said, can you please? I told him about Kenneth and Gloria's partnership from day one. And so I said to him, how about you giving Kenneth a word and give the leaders a word? And he said, okay. So I'm waiting for him, and he says, you want to take a message next week to Texas for me? I said, yes, sir. I said, do you want me to write it down? He said, why don't we make a video? So we've edited it, and it had subtitles because he speaks in Italian. He doesn't speak English. He tries in the beginning, but then he switches to Italian straight away. It's a historic moment. Let me just pause there. It is a historic moment. Continuing. This is the first pope in history that has took Francis's name because he is openly charismatic. And this is history, that we've got a pope who recognizes us as brothers and sisters, speaks to us as brothers and sisters, and has sent a message to us. And you will see what the message is about. So this is the background. This is the background to really what's coming next, which is what's important. So if you thought this was enlightening, if you thought this was interesting, if you thought this was informative, friends, we're just beginning now. This is just the background to what we have to learn about now. So he says this, Palmer is speaking now still to the people at Kenneth Copeland Ministries. These leaders, these ministerial leaders from all over the country, these are the guys who had the jets, who had the churches of thousands, 10,000, 20,000. These are the big fishes, as he calls them. He says this, and I need you to at least understand a little bit of the history behind this because we are living in an incredibly important generation. I believe that God has brought me here to this minister's conference in the spirit of Elijah. Let me explain. If you look carefully, the spirit of Elijah was on John the Baptist to turn the hearts of the sons to the fathers and to turn the hearts of the fathers to the sons to prepare the way for the Lord. And we know that prophecy always has a double fulfillment. And we know that Elijah will come before the second coming as well. And I've understood that the spirit of Elijah is the spirit of reconciliation to return hearts to each other. This is very important. And the truth is, friends, it is very important to understand what we're talking about here. We certainly know that the Elijah message is important. And Malachi, in fact, does mention the hearts of the children and the hearts of the father being drawn together. We could read it if you turn with me to Malachi chapter 4, last book of the Old Testament. Malachi chapter 4, in the last two verses, closes out the canon of the Old Testament. It says, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Now I want to ask you a question. Did Elijah promote the unification of Baal worship and that of Jehovah while striving for unity and reconciliation? No, he didn't. And in fact, Elijah, with his own hands, slew the prophets of Baal. The message of Elijah, friends, is not a message of unity of Baal worship and Jehovah together at all. He would have no fellowship or agreement with Baal. And the truth is that in the New Testament, that John declared that the message of John the Baptist was indeed a fulfillment of the Elijah prophecy of Malachi. And you can read about that in the first part of Matthew chapter 11. But the great and terrible day of the Lord did not come in John's day. And so instead of, as Tony Palmer says, we look for a second fulfillment, I say we look for the completion of the fulfillment in the end time, not necessarily a second fulfillment, because that's a Jesuit idea. But Palmer declares all prophecy says to have this double fulfillment. But what about this end time idea? The prophecy of Elijah that Malachi speaks of is that of drawing the hearts of the parents to the children and the children to the fathers. But I'm going to ask you, in what way? Because I'm afraid we haven't thought about that much before. In what way? What does this mean in its historical context with Elijah, as well as its applied context in the day of John? It is only as we understand these that we can know how to apply it today. Now let's think back to the time of Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 17, 1 Kings chapter 18. During this time, under the influence of Jezebel, Israel had fallen deeply into the worship of Baal. They had apostatized from Jehovah. Elijah came to denounce the worship of Baal and to call for the worship of Jehovah. After 3.5 years of drought, Elijah called for a meeting on Mount Carmel. And there the prophets of Baal were to assemble. There he would assemble with the nation of Israel. There was one person who was conspicuously absent. Who was that? Jezebel. She wouldn't come. She defied the prophet. And Elijah says, okay, we're going to have a contest. You rear up an altar, you lay on the wood, you lay on the sacrifice, but don't you set a match to it, and you call upon your God, and the God that calls, that answers by fire, will worship him. They all said, okay. But the prophets of Baal miserably failed to bring rain. And so Elijah, he repaired the altar of Jehovah, he set the wood in order, he put the sacrifice on, and he called for water. And how many barrels of water? 12 barrels of water, that's right. 12 barrels of water. Soaked it. And the Lord sent fire down from heaven, but he didn't do it until Elijah prayed. And I want you to notice the last part of Elijah's prayer. At 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 37. 1 Kings 18, verse 37. He says, "Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again." Did we read something in Malachi about something getting turned? The hearts need to be turned, friends, but the hearts need to be turned ultimately to God. Malachi is not talking about a generation gap, friends. He's talking about a problem between children and parents and different groups who are worshiping different gods, and they have to be called back to the worship of the true God. And when we do that, we fix the heart problem, friends. And if you look at the context in the time of John the Baptist, did John the Baptist say anything about the nuclear family and fathers and children and mothers and daughters or anything? He didn't say anything about that, did he? But he was preaching a message that would heal those wounds where they may have been, but it would bring everybody together as their hearts were turned to God. This is the prophecy of Malachi. And it's what we need to understand. That's so important. The message of Elijah was, "Behold your God." And that is the message that God has for his people to give today in this three angels' messages. God wants fathers and children together, parents and children together, in the worship of him. And if we can fix that, friends, we'll fix everything else. Today, there is a people who is to carry this Elijah message of "Behold your God." This message planted and nurtured in the heart will indeed draw the hearts of all kindred Christian spirits toward one another because they have been drawn toward God. And this message will prepare people to not only meet the true God, but also his son, Jesus Christ, at the second coming. And that's what I want. Now let's go ahead and notice what else Palmer says. Palmer says, "We know that the first 1,000 years," he's referring now to the Christian era, "we know that the first 1,000 years there was one church. It was called the Catholic Church. And the word Catholic means universal. It doesn't mean Roman. Raise your hand if you're born again." And I'll just pause here to tell you that he waited for people to raise their hands, and then he looked at the people and he said, "You're a Catholic." He says, "Take back, redeem what belongs to you. We are Catholics." Then there was a split at the end of the first millennium. We had the Orthodox East and West, two churches. Then 500 years later, we have Luther in his protest, three churches. Three denominations, not three churches. And then from Luther's protest onward, 33,000 new denominations. Friends, this is simply just not true. This is not an accurate portrayal of the facts. The church did not go for 1,000 years without having some kind of division, if you please. Because Paul, for instance, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7, he said in his day that the mystery of iniquity doth what? Already work. Even in his day, that's right. And there were epistles spoken of by the prophet John. If you read 2 John and 3 John, you can see that there was division already occurring even in that time. There was splintering, if you want to call it that. Some divisions are well known by the names of the leaders of the movement. For example, we know in the 4th century there arose a man by the name of Arius. Ever hear of a man by the name of Arius? Mm-hmm. And there was division, there was splintering. And Arius, for instance, raised objections to the worship of a false god. And by the time the papacy became well established, friends, the true church had to go into hiding in the wilderness. In Revelation chapter 12, we should read that. Revelation chapter 12, verses 13 and 14. "And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child." And the woman represents God's true church, doesn't it? And it says, "And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness and to her place, where she is nurtured for a time and times and half a time from the face of the serpent." Now, you Bible students who have studied this prophecy out, as well as the prophecy in Daniel 7 and complementary prophecies, you know that there are very specific time dates that we can tack onto this prophecy. And it begins when? A.D. 538. That's a long time before the first millennium ended, friends. The true church wasn't even in the open at the end of the first millennium. It was in hiding. And it was that way until 3.5 prophetic years, or until the year 1798. That's right. The same period of time that's spoken of in Daniel chapter 7, we read about that earlier in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. We read it about the time, times, and dividing of times. The 3.5 years. The Bible, in Bible prophecy, a day of prophecy equals 1 year of literal time. If we use the biblical rule of 360 days to the Bible year, we have 3.5 times that, or 1,260 years. And again, that's the time period from AD 538 to AD 1798. This was a time when the church went into hiding. And now please make sure you're sitting down well as I go to the next statement of Palmer that we're going to look at this morning. Palmer says, I've come to understand that diversity is divine. It's division that's diabolical. It's true what you were saying about the glory. I agree with you. Of course it's true. The glory that the Father had, He gave to Jesus. The glory was the presence of God. What is the charismatic renewal? It is when we experience the presence of God. And He says, and I give them the glory, pragmatic reason, so that they may be one. It's the glory that glues us together, not the doctrines. Now, I want you to think about this for just a minute. Well, let's go ahead. I think there's another part of the statement we should read. He says, it's the glory. If you accept that Christ is living in me and the presence of God is in me and the presence of God is in you, that's all we need, because God will sort out all our doctrines when we get upstairs. Therefore, Christian unity is the basis of our credibility, because Jesus said, until they are all one, we will not believe. The world will not believe as they should until we are one. Division destroys our credibility. It is fear that keeps us separated, because fear is false evidence appearing real. An acronym, F-E-A-R, false evidence appearing real. Because most of your fear is based on propaganda. But friends, let's not deal with propaganda today. Let's look at the facts. Let's look at the facts. He says in this paragraph that division is diabolical. But I'm going to tell you what this man has said is what is diabolical today. Unity in error is not blessed. It is God in His Word, friends, that calls for division and separation from evil and even from professed Christians who hold false doctrines. Let us read what the Word of God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And that was verse 16 and now 17 to go with it. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Does God say that we should just harmonize with everyone, let Him deal with the doctrines upstairs later? He doesn't say that, friends. He says to come out. Revelation chapter 18, 4. Let's look at it. Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, let me ask you first of all, where does the voice originate from?
Heaven.
Heaven. And the first thing that this voice says, come out of her, my people. Do angels call us their people? Christ can call us His people because we are His. But He says, I have people who are in false churches, false places, and they are thinking they're doing God's service. He says, but you've got to come to a knowledge of truth, and you've got to come out.
That's right.
And He says why they have to come out. He says, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. And it's interesting when He says that ye be not partakers of her sins. The Greek word that's translated partakers is also translated in other places fellowship. In other words, that you don't have fellowship with her sins. That's the Word of God. We are not to stay in these places. In 2 John, the epistle 2 John, it's very close to where we're at now. In verse 9, John says, whosoever transgresses and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. Friends, I don't think you can say it any stronger than this. He's saying very clearly here in 2 John verses 9 through 11 that we cannot be a partaker of these evil deeds. And these evil deeds are doctrines. And especially the doctrine that denies the Father and the Son, a doctrine like the Trinity doctrine, says there really is no Father, there really is no Son. You just have these three co-equal gods that play roles of Father and Son, and Jesus really isn't the Son of God at all. And friends, I can't believe that for a minute. Well, we could look at several other verses. I won't take time, but I'll give you some references if you'd like them. Isaiah 52:11, Isaiah 48:2, Jeremiah 50 verse 8, Jeremiah 51 verse 6. And interestingly, these verses speak about Babylon, coming out of Babylon. We are today living amidst spiritual Babylon, as it were. Palmer says that the charismatic renewal is experiencing the presence of God. But friends, the God that he is experiencing in this renewal is a false Holy Spirit. And Revelation chapter 16, verse 14, and Revelation chapter 13, verses 13 and 14 speak of the spirits of devils working miracles. They think it's a great Holy Spirit revival, and it is the spirit of devils working miracles. Amen. This miracle-working power is attributed to the Holy Spirit of God, but these professed Christians worship the Trinity, and they are confused, friends, on both the identity and the role of the Holy Spirit. Palmer is teaching that since God lives in all of us, we're all brothers and sisters, and we're not to allow doctrines to stand in the way of fellowship. He says that the doctrines are not the glue. He says rather it is the glory, or this charismatic experience of this false Holy Spirit experience in your life, that makes people one. Friends, there's two big problems with that. Firstly, this spirit, as we mentioned in the modern emerging celebration church, is that this spirit in the Pentecostal movement, this spirit is not from God. Amen. It is from the devil. Because, friends, first of all, we know it's not from God because it doesn't lead people to keep the commandments of God. And the Holy Spirit is never going to lead people away from keeping the commandments of God. Secondly, what Palmer says is not what the Bible says about unity. In Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 13, Paul says, till we all come in the unity of the faith. Not the unity of a fellowship, the unity of the faith. And of the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man. Friends, all we need is the knowledge of the Son of God. It's a unity on understanding who Jesus Christ is and everything that comes out of that. That's where our unity can be at. We have been told that we are to unify, but according to Selected Messages, Book 1, page 175, it must be upon a scriptural basis. It's not to be on just the idea of having fellowship, the idea of having fun. You know, we can go down to the Rotary Club, we can go to the Elks Club, we can go to the Moose Club, we can go somewhere else if we just want to meet with people. If we just want to get along, we can go somewhere else. We can go to the high school reunions. Anything less, friends, is not true unity. In the book Great Controversy, on page 563, we are told this. And this is true, friends. Look at this and see if it doesn't ring true as a bell. Romanism is now regarded by Protestants with far greater favor than in former years. Let me just stop there. The statement was originally written over 100 years ago. Do you think it would be even more strongly applicable today? Romanism is now regarded by Protestants with far greater favor than in former years. In those countries where Catholicism is not in the ascendancy, and the papists are taking a conciliatory course in order to gain influence, there is an increasing indifference concerning the doctrines that separate the Reformed churches from the papal hierarchy. The opinion is gaining ground that, after all, we do not differ so widely upon vital points as has been supposed, and that a little concession on our part will bring us into a better understanding with Rome. Is that what we're hearing today? Is that not what the message of Bishop Palmer is? Exactly. Palmer declares that our Christian unity is the basis of the believer's credibility in the world. He claims that the world will sit up and take notice of Christianity when we have this unity that he's speaking about. Palmer doesn't quote a text, but the reference surely is in John 17. John chapter 17, and in verse 21, that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me? Well, that's a true text. Isn't that true? But friends, it's not all that Jesus said. It's not all that Jesus prayed. It's not the context under which Jesus prayed. Look back in verse 17 now. Jesus is praying. He says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And verse 18, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified. How? Through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one as we are one. And how are they going to be one? Because they all believe the same truth, friends. They're all sanctified by the truth. That's the basis of unity. That is the basis of the unity. Palmer says that it is fear that keeps us separated. But beloved, I think that we should be afraid. We should be terrified to join up with the harlot and her daughters.
That's right.
And that point that I've just made is not based upon propaganda, but upon the Word of God. We should be fearful, friends. We should be fearful to sanction sin. We should be fearful to let go of the sinner and make no effort to restore them. We should be fearful to let something like this happen, and we are quiet about it. Palmer said this is historic. He goes on to say, now why is it historic? Because in 1999, the Roman Catholic Church and the Protestant Lutheran Church signed an agreement that brought an end to the protest. I'm not sure if you know that or not, but we're going to talk about the details here in a minute. He continues, Luther believed that we were saved by grace through faith alone. Amen? But that's not it. The Catholic Church believed that we were saved by works, and that was the protest. So what these two churches did, they put the two definitions together. Listen to it. I'm reading verbatim from the Catholic Vatican website. Let me just pause. He claims that what he's going to read next comes from the Vatican Catholic website. Justification means that Christ himself is our righteousness, in which we share through the Holy Spirit in accord with the will of the Father. Together, we Catholics and Protestants, Lutherans, believe and confess that by grace alone, in faith in Christ's saving works, and not because of any merit on our part, we are accepted by God and receive the Holy Spirit, who renews our hearts while equipping and calling us to good works. Now, this is where the facts begin to become even more garbled and fuzzy. Because the fact is that there was an agreement in 1999 signed between the Vatican and a group of Lutherans. And that group was called the Lutheran World Federation, or also known as LWF. And from their own website, I believe, they say that the LWF, or the Lutheran World Federation, is a global communion of 142 churches in the Lutheran tradition, representing over 70 million Christians in 79 countries. So the World Lutheran Federation has been studying with the Roman Catholic Church since Vatican II, and they have more plans. They have plans for events in 2014. But within America, within the United States, the largest branch of Lutherans and the largest that belong to the World Lutheran World Federation is called the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, ELCA. And this is the largest group of Lutherans in America by far, and they are the largest group of Lutherans in this group. But this is a very liberal church. This is the Lutheran, the branch of the Lutherans that ordain women as priests, that ordain homosexuals as priests, just so you know. And they certainly do not represent all Lutherans, though they may represent the majority. I think there are some Lutherans who still protest. But the Lutheran World Federation did sign a joint statement on faith, of faith on justification in 1999, but it was not as simple as Tony Palmer made it sound. Palmer says that he's reading a verbatim quote. When I say verbatim, what does it mean? Word for word exact. I'm not varying from the script at all. I'm not paraphrasing now. But he did. Where he says, together we Catholics and Protestants, Lutherans believe and confess. The text does not say Catholics and Protestants, Lutherans believe. And it says together we confess. In other words, it was between Catholics and some Lutherans, but he put Protestants in there. But that's not in the text at all. Just so you know that. And while the agreement was between Catholics and Lutherans, it does not say Protestants, and I, for one Protestant, object to being included in a verbatim statement. In our next slide, we actually have a portion of that joint resolution we can read. It says, in faith, we together hold the conviction that justification is the work of the triune God. So where does all their soteriology get its foundation? In their Christology of the Trinity. The Father sent His Son into the world to save sinners. The foundation, presupposition of justification is the incarnation, death, and resurrection of Christ. Justification thus means that Christ Himself is our righteousness in which we share through the Holy Spirit in accord with the will of the Father. Together we confess by grace alone, in faith in Christ's saving work, and not because of any merit on our part. We are accepted by God and receive the Holy Spirit who renews our hearts while equipping and calling us to good works. Well, that sounds good, doesn't it? That sounds like something that we might agree with. We might think that that's the truth. But I want you to remember this. In Great Controversy on page 571, it is part of her, the papacy's policy, to assume the character which will best accomplish her purpose, but beneath the variable appearance of the chameleon, she conceals the invariable venom of the serpent. Yes, friends, the joint declaration uses the expression by grace alone, but they do not define how this grace is achieved. And it is a long-held belief in Catholicism that we are prepared for grace through our works. Furthermore, when the document uses the expression faith alone, and you find this expression a couple times in the document, faith alone, it's always in reference to the Lutheran's position and not the joint position. And they go on in the appendix, and I will just abbreviate part of this, but it's here for you. It says, where, however, Lutheran teaching construes the relation of God to His human creatures in justification with such emphasis on the divine monergism or the sole efficacy of Christ in such a way that the person's willing acceptance of God's grace, which is itself a gift of God, has no essential role in justification, then the Trident canons 4, 5, 6, and 9 still constitute a notable doctrinal difference on justification. What he's saying is that there are differences still. They're saying we're not totally in agreement. There are some things we aren't agreeing about that we say that we're in agreement on, but I'm going to tell you, friends, Rome doesn't change. It's not Rome that's changing. Not at all. The scope of what we're looking at today doesn't include, we don't have time to look at all the subtle differences, but I want to rest assured that Rome has not changed. The Council of Trent has not been repudiated. And in fact, notice this statement from the Council of Trent that was made in the year 1547 in Trento, Italy. Canon number 9, this is session 6 of the Council of Trent. If anyone saith that by faith alone the impious is justified in such wise as to mean that nothing else is required to cooperate in order to the obtaining of grace of justification, and that it is not in any way necessary that he be prepared and disposed by the movement of his own will, let him be anathema. Let him be cursed. It means let him be damned. Let him have damnation. That's exactly what they believe. And we could read Canon 14, we could read Canon 21, and we could read other portions that say basically the same thing. And they all end with anathema. But what does the Word of God say in Romans chapter 3? Let's just notice a few verses quickly. Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. Therefore by the deeds of the law there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of what?
Sin.
Verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. In chapter 4, verse 3, what saith the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for what? Righteousness. Why? Because he believed. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We're justified how? It says by faith. And for instance, by faith alone. It doesn't say by faith and works. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For by grace are you saved through what? Through faith. For it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And we could read Titus 3, 5, and several other references today. The Council of Trent, though, one of the statements that I'd like to just share with you, canon number 33, it says, if anyone saith that by the Catholic doctrine touching justification, by this holy synod insert forth in this present decree, the glory of God or the merits of our Lord Jesus Christ are in any way derogated from, and not rather that the truth of our faith and the glory and fine of God and of Jesus Christ are rendered more illustrious, let him be anathema. Now, that's a little confusing at the first reading, but what it simply means is that if there's anyone who disagrees with what this council says, let him be anathema. That's what it's saying. If you don't agree with the way we're saying this, you be anathema. You be damned. The council declares this quite plainly. Well, Palmer, despite whether he knows this or not, maybe he's never read the Council of Trent, but he told those people at that Pentecostal Charismatic Conference, he said this, referring to the signing of this 1999 signing of this joint resolution, he says, this brought an end to the protest of Luther. Brothers and sisters, Luther's protest is over. It's yours. In 1999, this was signed by the Lutheran Church, the Federation Worldwide. Later, about 5 years later, the Worldwide Methodists signed the same agreement, but as of today, we still have no Protestant evangelical that will stand up and sign this agreement to agree with our brothers and sisters that we are saved by grace through faith to good works, and I believe that's something that needs to be fixed. There's a challenge for you. In other words, you should reunite with Rome on this. But, beloved, the Lutherans' protest may be over, but mine is not. Is yours? To clarify, though, this statement about the Methodists signing onto this statement, we need to understand the facts. And the facts are that on July the 18th of 2006, about 7 years later, members of the World Methodist Council, that's the WMC, World Methodist Council, meeting in Seoul, South Korea, voted unanimously to adopt the Declaration on the Doctrine of Justification. Now, the World Methodist Council is a consultative body and association of churches in the Methodist tradition. It comprises 76 member denominations, not just one Methodist church, but 76 different denominations, different branches of Methodists, as we see here, from 132 countries representing about 75 million people, among them the United Methodist Church, the Free Methodist Church, the United Church of Christ in the Philippines, the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, the United Church of Canada, the British Methodist Church, the United Church of Australia, the Wesleyan Church, and the Church of the Nazarene. And I was so surprised when I saw that last one, because I have a good friend who's an ordained minister in the Church of the Nazarene, so I called him. And I said, my brother, do you know anything about this group? Is your church a member of this group, and did you agree with the signing of this document with the Vatican? He says, I don't know anything about it. And I don't know that the average member in the pew understands all these things or has even heard of them, because I called St. Louis, Missouri, where the world headquarters of the Church of the Nazarene are, and I talked to one of the representatives. They said, oh yeah, we're a member of this World Methodist Conference. We're part of that. Sure enough. So when Tony Palmer says that nobody else agrees or stand up, he's not totally accurate. There's actually more people already got loaded on the boat than he realizes. And people ignorant of it. That's right. So he continues. Palmer continues. So the protest has been over for 15 years. And I challenge my Protestant pastor friends, if there is no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church? And I'll just stop there. You know, friends, he's right. If there isn't a protest, why do we have Protestant churches? The logic is not wrong at this point. Friends, there is still a protest. It says, maybe we are now all Catholics again, but we are Reformed. We are Catholic in the universal sense. We are not protesting the doctrine of salvation by the Catholic Church anymore. We now preach the same gospel. We now preach you're saved by grace through faith alone. The word alone was the argument for 500 years. The word alone is there. You can read it yourself. The protest is over. The protest is over. Friends, that word alone doesn't mean what everyone thinks it means. And I want to tell you, the protest isn't over, and we're not all preaching the same gospel. They may have the same Christology, and that leads them to have the same soteriology. But it's not my Christology nor my sortology, friends. Neither one. Notice the steps that Palmer takes. He falsely states that the protest is over because there's nothing to protest. There should be no protest in church. And you know, friends, it's true that the distance between the Protestant or the Protestant churches and the Rome is far less than it once was. But it's not because Rome has moved. Rome never changes. Rome's not moving. It's because the Protestants have moved toward Rome. But for those who have not and will not move, the protest continues. And I say it continues, friends, in the strongest terms. We refuse, I refuse, to be categorized as Catholic in any manner. And we state clearly that there is much that prevents our unification, including a proper understanding of justification, but not limiting it to that. We cannot, and I will not, accept papal monstrosities such as papal infallibility, the Trinity, Mariology, transubstantiation, you know what that means, that's the Mass, prayers to saints, limbo, purgatory, the immortal soul, deuterocanonical books, worship of the Pope, and many other such abominations. What about the great teaching of sola scriptura? Are you ready to give up sola scriptura? I'm not. And clearly the Roman Catholic Church does not even pretend that scripture is the sole authority for its faith and practice. For this essential fact to be ignored shows the duplicity or the ignorance of the unity movement. But friends, the protest is not over. The word alone, again, is in the document on justification, but looking under the surface of the document, it is clear that the meaning is not what the Protestants think. Palmer, nearing the end of his talk, says this, "I challenge you to find a bridge builder and back him or her." A bridge builder. Bridge builders. You know, bridges join sections that are separated, right? Have you ever heard the name Pontifex Maximus? It was a title that the Roman emperors used, decreed upon themselves. It's also one of the titles that the Pope uses today. And in Latin, it literally means the great bridge builder. The great bridge builder. That's who the Pope claims to be. And the Pope is the bridge builder that Tony Palmer wants everyone to find. Palmer then ends his discussion by quoting from John 17, verses 20 through 23 in the New King James Bible, and says, "Glory to the Father, amen." But the prayer of Christ that includes the text that Palmer read from includes John 17, 17 that we read earlier, that we are to be sanctified through the truth. Because Jesus didn't know a sanctification apart from the truth. In John chapter 8 and verse 32, he says, "You shall know the truth, and truth will what? Make you free." That's right. And so, after this discussion, after this introduction, Palmer played the video of the Pope. And Palmer noted that the video was edited, and we don't have access to an unedited version. We don't know how much was edited, or if anything was edited, perhaps except the subtitles being put in. There aren't any places that I noticed quickly, or at least easily, that you could see a cut break in the video. And so, I should give you a little bit, and this is partly edited because of our time constraints. I should give you a little bit of what the Pope said in the video. So kindly, so lovingly, so gently, so friendly. You can look it up on the internet if you haven't seen it yet. It's available. It's easy to find. He says, "Dear brothers and sisters," notice how he speaks to these estranged brothers and sisters, these people who at one time would have just simply been labeled in an outward way heretic. But remember, the Council of Trent says, if you don't agree with us, you're damned, you're a heretic. "Dear brothers and sisters, excuse me because I speak in Italian, but I'm not speaking English." And then he goes into Italian. He says, "Two rules, love God above all and love the other, your neighbor, because he is your brother and sister. With these two rules, we can go ahead. I'm here with my brother, my bishop friend, Tony Palmer. We've been friends for years. We can see that God is working all over the world. There are families. They don't love each other. Families that come together and families who separate themselves. We are kind of, permit me to say, separated. Separated because it's sin that has separated us. All our sins. The misunderstandings throughout history. It has been a long road of sins that we've all shared in. Who is to blame? We all share the blame. We all have sinned. There's only one blameless, the Lord. I am nostalgic or yearning that This separation comes to an end and gives us communion. I am nostalgic, or it means yearning, of that embrace that the Holy Scriptures speak of when Joseph's brothers began to starve from hunger. They went to Egypt to buy so that they could eat. They went to buy. They had money, but they couldn't eat the money. But there they found something more than food. They found their brother. All of us have currency. The currency of our culture, the currency of our history. We have a lot of cultural riches and religious riches, and we have diverse traditions, but we have to encounter one another as brothers. We must cry together like Joseph did. These tears will unite us, the tears of love. I am speaking to you as a brother. I'm speaking to you in a simple way with joy and nostalgia. Let us allow our nostalgia to grow because this will propel us to find each other, to embrace one another, and together to worship Jesus Christ as the only Lord of history. Please pray for me because I need your prayers, and I will pray for you. I will do it, but I need your prayers, and let us pray to the Lord that He unites us all. Come on, we are brothers. Let's give each other a spiritual hug and let God complete the work that He has begun. And this is a miracle. The miracle of unity has begun. I ask you to bless me, and I bless you. From brother to brother, I embrace you. Thank you. And that was the Pope's message back to Kenneth Copeland and all those evangelicals. Clearly, Tony Palmer does have a close relationship with the Pope. Francis declares that they've been friends for years. The Pope calls Palmer his brother and addresses these listening to the video as brothers as well. He speaks of the separation that they have had and says that it's because of sin. But Francis does not accept the blame because of the damnable doctrines and monstrosities of Rome, such as the Inquisition, which necessitated the Reformation, which necessitated the separation. No, he says that we're all to blame, and he states that we've all sinned, and only Christ is blameless. But friends, this is ignoring the issues, and it's casting blame where it does not need to be resting. The Pope then speaks of the brothers of Joseph, who went to Egypt to buy corn, and that they found their brother. And he tries to imply a modern-day parallel. Joseph's brothers represent the Protestants, and of course, the papacy, the Pope. He's represented by Joseph in this parable. But notice that Joseph did not go down to meet his brothers halfway, but rather they came all the way to him. And in the Bible, Egypt is symbolic of sin. And in reality, the Protestants, friends, are going to meet the man of sin. This is highly symbolic. It really is. The Pope says that we are to embrace one another and together to worship Jesus Christ as the only Lord of history. And you know, that sounds so good. I mean, on the surface, all of this sounds so good. But friends, it is not the Pope who will move in doctrine and worship to the Protestants, but the Protestants to the Pope. And again, the Pope emphasizes that he and his listeners are brothers, and he wants to give them a spiritual hug. He says, this miracle of unity has begun. And clearly, a work of unity has begun. No question about that. But it's not the work of God, it's the work of the God of the papacy, Satan. The Pope then declares that God will complete this work of unity. Well, friends, we don't worship the same Jesus Christ. I don't worship a Jesus Christ in a little wafer that's recreated by the priest every Mass. I don't worship the Jesus Christ that they know at all. The response to the Pope's message at Kenneth Copeland Ministries. The people gave the Pope a standing, roaring ovation and then began to raise their hands in praise as such a wonderful thing had happened. Kenneth Copeland then prayed for the Pope. The Pope had asked for their prayers. Kenneth Copeland prayed for the Pope, and he said he was in agreement with the Pope with his quest for the unity in the body of Christ. And Copeland then said that he would pray for the Pope in the Spirit with words that are not his own, and then he goes off into speaking with tongues. After that, he asked Tony Palmer, he says, Tony, come back up on the platform. He says, bring your camera, because I want to make a video for you to take back to the Pope. And so Kenneth Copeland made a video. And here's what he said to the Pope. With pathos, with emotion, He said, "My dear sir. My dear sir, thank you so from the bottom of our hearts." All of these leaders represent literally tens of thousands of people that love you, that believe God with you. And in answer to your request, we have just prayed for you and with you. And we did so in the Spirit, and we believe we receive according to the words of Jesus in Mark 11:24, that whatsoever thing you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them, and you shall have them. Thank you, sir. We do bless you. We receive your blessing. It is very, very important to us. And we bless you with all our hearts. We bless you with all our souls. We bless you with all of our might. And we thank you, sir. We thank God for you. And so, all of us together, and then Copeland turns to the congregation, be blessed. Once again, all together, be blessed. Amen. 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 And Palmer tells Copeland, he says, "You're going to have to come to the Vatican." And to that, Copeland says, "I will. I'm available. Praise God. God's will be done. Amen." He says, "I'm telling you, heaven is thrilled over this." Now, friends, maybe you've not heard of Tony Palmer before today. I didn't know anything about him until I understood this report. Most Christians know something about Kenneth Copeland, and of course, everyone's heard about Pope Francis. They're all big-time players. But friends, regardless of the means, we see hands reaching across the Gulf, uniting among former enemies. And I'm reminded of what the servant of the Lord wrote, again in the book Great Controversy on page 563. "The time was when Protestants placed a high value upon the liberty of conscience, which had been so dearly purchased. They taught their children to abhor popery and held that to seek harmony with Rome would be disloyalty to God. But how widely different are the sentiments now expressed." We love you. We praise God for you, he says about the Pope. On page 588 of Great Controversy, "The Protestants of the United States will be foremost in stretching their hands across the Gulf to grasp the hand of spiritualism. They will reach over the abyss to clasp the hands with the Roman power, and under the influence of this threefold union, this axis of evil we talked about earlier, this country will follow in the steps of Rome in trampling upon the rights of conscience." And we see it happening, friends, more and more. Two of the great errors that both the papists and the vast majority of Protestants agree upon are the Trinity doctrine and Sunday sacredness. Adventism has fully embraced the first and is flirting with the second in many ways. When pressure is brought forth, it will be declared that we all worship the same God. Therefore, we should worship this God, the Trinity, on the day dedicated to the Trinity. And you know what day that is, don't you? Sunday is the day dedicated to the worship of the Trinity. And when pressure is brought to bear and favors need to be repaid, here's what's going to happen. We've been told in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 81. "The time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. The mark of the beast will be urged upon us. Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be, rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death." A prototype of this kind of yielding could be seen in different events, but I'm just going to mention one. Anybody recognize this person by picture? He's probably the best-known Seventh-day Adventist in the world. His name is Dr. Benjamin Carson. He's retired head of pediatric neurosurgery from Johns Hopkins University, and by all indications, he's running for president. I didn't say he's running. He seems to be setting the stage for a presidential run, clearly doing that. The last 2 years, he spoke at what's called CPAC. It's a conservative, big meeting of conservative Republicans mostly, but conservative political people. And he spoke this year at CPAC. And he did it this year just like he did it last year on Sabbath. Not just happened to be on Saturday night after sundown. This particular year, he spoke right about during the worship hour time. This was his job, was to portray a political message. Now, I respect Dr. Carson's abilities tremendously. He had gifted hands, probably still does if he was going to do surgery. Has been tremendously influential in a lot of ways. And if I listen to the things he says politically, I probably agree with 98% of it. But friends, if we start to compromise in place, and then we see the most renowned people of our church compromising, and then you don't hear anything about this, you don't hear any negative publicity about this, do you? Not a bit. We're not saying anything. He sets the stage, friends, for the rest of us to start making compromises. And if he's on the presidential trail later, friends, he's going to be out there on Sabbath. He's already set the precedent. Why should he stop then? If he stops then, he'll look like a hypocrite. Another prototype I told you about Wednesday night, those of you who are with us Wednesday night, an Adventist elementary school was told by the government to meet certain requirements. But the school didn't want to meet those requirements. They didn't feel obligated to. But they were reminded by the government that that school, in its breakfast program every morning, served government milk, milk supplied by the government. They said, you will do this. And they did. And they did. Friends, acceptance by the other churches, continuation of the 501c3 status, will not be given up by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Compromise instead will be made. In the book, Great Controversy Again, now if you haven't read that book, I suggest you should. And if you've read it, I suggest you should read it again. On page 533, we are told it was by satanic aid that Pharaoh's magicians were enabled to counterfeit the work of God. Paul testifies that before the second advent of Christ, there will be similar manifestations of satanic power. The coming of the Lord is to be preceded by the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders with all deceivableness of unrighteousness, 2 Thessalonians 2. 9 and 10. Friends, the Pentecostal charismatic ecumenical movement is exactly on target for the celebration style emerging church to accept, which seeks to minimize doctrine and emphasize spirit and fellowship. How do you think the people who reject the Pentecostal emerging church will be received? How will they be received? Jesus told us in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 9. Jesus said, "Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake." That's right. And we've been told also in Great Controversy on page 590 and 591, and yes, we are wrapping up, but we have a few more important things, so just bear with us a little bit more, please. We're getting close. The miracle-working power manifested through spiritualism. Through who? Spiritualism. Let me just pause again. Remember, you've got these apostate Protestant Pentecostals. And you have a joining already of spiritualism. We were told that it would be the Protestants that would first join with spiritualism and then with Catholicism. And that's exactly what's happening. The miracle-working power manifested through spiritualism will exert its influence against those who choose to obey God rather than man. Communications from the spirits will declare that God has sent them to convince the rejectors of Sunday of their error, affirming that the laws of the land should be obeyed as the law of God. They will lament the great wickedness in the world and second the testimony of religious teachers that the degraded state of morals is caused by the desecration of Sunday. Great will be the indignation excited against all who refuse to accept their testimony. Great will be the indignation, friends. Beloved, we may not be at the end of the end, but we are certainly near it. We know that according to Bible prophecy, there are some things that are yet to happen soon, but we can see the stage being set. Coming events have been casting their shadows, and the reality is now upon us. USA Today report, as well as other news agencies, that on March the 13th, House Speaker John Boehner, Republican from Ohio, extended a formal open invitation to Pope Francis to address a joint meeting of Congress. When it says it's an open invitation, that means you can come anytime you want. It's an open invitation. Boehner is a Roman Catholic, and he's made this invitation to his Catholic leader. The USA Today report continued, said, "His address as a visiting head of state before a joint meeting of the House and Senate would honor our nation in keeping with the best traditions of our democratic institutions. It would also offer an excellent opportunity for the American people as well as the nations of the world to hear his message in full." We're not going to stifle him in any way. In other words, the Pope is being invited to use the United States Capitol, the Congress of the United States, as his pulpit. As his pulpit. The USA Today also reported that House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, you ever heard of her, who is also a Roman Catholic and normally a bitter political enemy with Boehner, has joined Boehner in welcoming Pope Francis to Congress. The article also noted that Pelosi attended his inauguration at the Vatican and praised him as a moral force. Friends, if the Pope speaks from the United States Capitol building with the full support of Congress, it would certainly constitute a repudiation of our Constitution.
That's right.
You see, we've been told that, and maybe I should be a little more specific, it would certainly constitute a repudiation of the principles of our Constitution. Because we've been told it's the principles of our Constitution. We're never told it's the Constitution itself that's going to be set aside. Some Adventists have been looking for a constitutional amendment to come, but she says the principles are set aside. We can keep the Constitution, but we can set aside its principles, you see.
Case law.
And so we read now in Volume 5, page 451, when Protestantism shall stretch her hand across the gulf to grasp the hand of the Roman power, when she shall reach over the abyss to clasp hands with spiritualism, when, under the influence of this threefold union, our country shall repudiate every principle of its Constitution as a Protestant and Republican government, and shall make provision for the propaganda of papal falsehoods and delusions, then we may know that the time has come for the marvelous working of Satan and that the end is near. And this is the statement that I needed. This is it. And you need this statement too. Because we see this happening. And if this government is going to give the Pope a chance to do that, friends, to promulgate his doctrine here, Boehner says this is a chance to give his full message. Then we know, friends, that the time is near for the marvelous working of Satan. Simply, friends, though, knowing last day events and knowing the schedule for these events, if we could put all these events on a timeline, that's not enough. That can't save us. Though the prophet Hosea says, "My people perish for lack of knowledge," knowledge itself will not save us. And the devil knows that far better than even we do. Only Jesus can save us. He is our only hope. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Peter said that neither is there any other name under heaven given by whereby we receive salvation except through Jesus Christ in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Friends, if we are not securely in Christ today, then knowing these things won't help us. The appeal that we must have today is that we must have Jesus. And we must be on guard, friends. It's true, we must be on guard. We certainly should be watching the signs of the times. But above all, we must trust in Jesus. We must cling to Him. We must say like Jacob did, "I will not let thee go except thou bless me." Genesis 32, 26. That's what we have to have, each one of us. And until we have that, friends, we have no security. And Jesus says, you can be saved by grace. For by grace are you saved through faith. But friends, it's an obedience that leads to the commandments of God. Because we quoted, and let's just turn over to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. We quoted verse 8. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." Verse 9, we also quoted, "Not of works, lest any man should boast." But now notice verse 10. "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." You know, Tony Palmer even talked about that. He said, "Well, we're saved by grace alone, to good works." But friends, they don't believe that keeping these commandments is important. The good works here, friends, includes not just acts of charity, doing kind things, speaking, you know, with a smile and softly. It includes keeping all God's commandments, friends. Every single one. Finally, I'd like to read to you, in closing, a statement from the book, not the book Great Controversy, rather, but from the Review and Herald of November the 8th, 1892. And if we had time, we could go into the context of the timing of this statement. It's interesting, and it is important, but we don't have time today. But she says, "The time is upon us. when the miracle-working power of the arch-deceiver will be more decidedly revealed, and his deceptions will increase in their delusive attraction so that they will perplex and, if possible, deceive who? Deceive the very elect. The prince of darkness with his evil angels is working upon the Christian world, inducing those who profess the name of Christ to stand under the banner of darkness, to make war with those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. An apostate church will unite with the powers of earth and hell to place upon the forehead or in the hand the mark of the beast and prevail upon the children of God to worship the beast and his image. They will seek to compel them to renounce their allegiance to God's law and yield homage to the papacy. Then will come the times which will try men's souls, for the confederacy of apostasy will demand that the loyal subjects of God shall renounce the law of Jehovah and repudiate the truth of his word. Then will the gold be separated from the dross, and it will be made apparent who are the godly and who are loyal and true and who are the disloyal, the dross and the tinsel. What clouds of chaff will then be borne away by the fan of God? Where now our eyes can discern only rich floors of wheat will the chaff be blown away with the fan of God. Everyone who is not centered in Christ will fail to stand the test and ordeal of that day. Please don't miss that. Doesn't matter what we know. It doesn't matter if we understand the timeline. If it doesn't matter if we can predict what's happening next with exact accuracy. Everyone who is not centered in Christ will fail to stand the test and ordeal of that day. Why, those who are clothed with Christ's righteousness will stand firm to truth and duty. Those who have trusted in their own righteousness will be ranged under the black banner of the prince of darkness. Then it will be seen whether the choice is for Christ or Baal. Those who have been self-distrustful, who have been so circumstanced that they have not dared to face stigma and reproach, will at last openly declare themselves for Christ and his law, while many who have appeared to be flourishing trees, but who have borne no fruit, will go with the multitude to do evil and will receive the mark of apostasy in the forehead or in their hand. Review and Herald of November 8, 1892. 1892, that's right. The time of test is just upon us. For the loud cry of the third angel has already begun in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ, the sin pardoning Redeemer, at the very same time. Things were happening, friends, and it was ready to go. But then it got shut off. We know it got shut off because it didn't finish. But now it's ready to go again. We're at that time again. And you know, I am just so thankful, beloved. I am so thankful that I'm alive today. I mean, I think like Martin Luther King did that one time when he talked about going back and where would you want to live at, Dr. Luther? Where would you want to live at? So I want to live right here at the latter part of the 20th century, but here I am, friends. And this is where I want to live. I'd like to have went through that 1844 experience and understood what it meant. I'd like to have been there in 1863. I'd like to have been there in 1888, but I'm more glad to be here today than there then. That's right. And you can be thankful to him, friends. God has put us here. You were born to be here today. You were born here to give this message and to be a part of this loud cry. And we can do it if we are centered in Christ. If he is our righteousness first and foremost. I know we haven't talked a lot about salvation today, friends, because hopefully I'm talking to people who profess to be born again. And if you're not, you need to be born again. You need to give yourself fully to the Lord. You need to get baptized. It's time. It's time to put away these habits. It's time to do the right thing and to follow the Lord Jesus. It's time.